no kazoos. There's no kazoos.
No kazoos in here. No. I got some Mardi Gras beads. Okay, oh well.
And then, oftentimes these commercials can evoke various scripts, whatever the scripts might be, but usually good and evil. I am good, that other person is evil, or other sort of social myths that Han talked about in that chapter on myth. And also, I mean, all that stuff impacts the news, because we see the melodramatic, you know, us versus them script or a story in the news. Okay, this is stuff that we did not get to, and again, I'm adding this. This is not in the book, but I do think it is relevant and important because this is sort of an idea about how research in social psychology can sort of help us think about the persuasion process when folks are not being terribly mindful about things and thoughtful about things. Ah, delicious water with lemon. Contrast, if you want to follow along, I mean, you can't see this. This idea that we contrast a second thing with the first thing to make the first second thing seem better than the first thing. My opponent raised taxes 2,000 times. I only raised taxes 1,000 and something. So it sounds, oh, that's a little bit better. It's like if you're working at Belk or something like that, you're trying to sell some shoes, because I worked at a shoe store once. Hey, here's some shoes for $150. Ooh, that's too expensive. Here's some shoes for $100. The $100 sounds better compared to the $150. Contrast. Reciprocity. If you give me this, if I give you this, I expect something in return. Here, I have mailed you a tote bag. Please vote for me, or I have mailed you address labels. Please give to my charity. But this idea of, hey, somebody came to my door, so I need to vote for them. Somebody gave me a yard sign, so I should put it up. It feels right. Do I know anything about this person? No. But I need to reciprocate. Consistency. Folks love consistency and tend to think that folks who are consistent are better, more honest, more ethical. Carrie, back in the day, lost in part because they called him a flip-flopper. People change their minds, but people love consistency. Consistency means good. Why? I don't know. Just because it seems right. Social proof. If something is popular, it must be good. Everybody's bandwagon fallacy as well. Everybody likes this, whatever it is. The new Justin Bieber or whatever, or Justin Timberlake, or whoever. They could be the same person for all I know. No, I'm joking. Oftentimes, polling is important because there's two different ways to look at polling, I think. Oftentimes, first, it's the horse race type stuff, and people gamble on all this crap. But oftentimes, folks, if they're undecided, we like to go with a winner. Looking at the polls, if you hear the news, so-and-so is high in the polls, and I want to go vote. But I don't want to vote for the losing side. I don't want to feel like I'm a loser. I want to be on the winning team. So sometimes people go vote just for whoever's up in the polls because they feel like, hey, I want to vote for the winner. The flip side of that sometimes is if the polls are really sort of like they are right now. I mean, Clinton is trouncing Trump in the polls. And I think folks are scared that everybody's going to assume, oh, Clinton's going to win. And so they don't go out and vote. Which, if that happens, I mean, that's could happen. Who knows what's going to go on. Liking, again, I say in the PowerPoint, oftentimes used in interpersonal settings, but it's used all over the place. And it's problematic. It's like if I like you, then I'm going to be persuaded by you, or I'm going to vote for you. you know, politicians don't have to be likable per se. I mean, it's part of that, but maybe they need to be smart and have good policy. But generally, we will vote for people who we tend to like, who, you know, the would I have a beer with this person test. Authority, oftentimes, I think we're a little bit weary of authority these days, although they always win. I fight authority. Authority always wins, but I am authority. Yeah, so I win. But people tend to think, oh, you know, Trump's an authority on business, therefore I should believe everything he says about taxes, blah, 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 blah. Or Clinton is authority on foreign policy, so I should believe everything, so. And then scarcity is the last sort of thing, and that is this idea that if something is scarce, people want it more. Limited quantities, as I say here. That's why logic and reasoning and intelligence is so wanted and attractive in Washington, D.C., because it's so scarce. But, you know, it's like for a limited time only. If you call within the next 10 minutes, you will receive a Make America Great Again pin. A knife. Look at this knife. It can cut through tinfoil, an aluminum can, and then a cantaloupe. And there's not a scratch. Order within the next 10 minutes and you get a live turkey that you can also use the knife to cut because Thanksgiving is coming. All right, so the idea here is that these are ways to persuade people when people are not being very mindful about things. And so we oftentimes see these in lots of persuasive messages, particularly in things like advertisements. So what we're going to do here, I'm going to take you through a brand new commercial. Well, I think it came out this week, but this extra handout that I had where I was going to ask you in class to actually sort of make a potential spot for Trump or Clinton. Here we're just going to use all these ideas as sort of an analytical template to try to understand the various persuasive elements of a particular piece of political communication, i.e. this Trump commercial. So, some things that I say here about one thing to think about, or several things to think about. I know you can't see this, but you can follow along online. What can you use from the general nature of the type of ad? So what type of ad is it, and does that impact how you understand the nature or what's going on there so far as the messages in the text? Can you see intensification through repetition? Can you see intensification through association? Can you see any other idea of intensification through the whole form or composition of the commercial? Does it downplay anything by omitting anything? Does it divert attention by focusing on certain abstract ideals or euphemism or whatever? Does it downplay by, you know, inflated language? Is there any way to frame or reframe through metaphors? I'm adding a metaphor here. Are there any metaphors in here, in the commercial? Is there a visual or voiceover that helps any of the intensification, downplaying, any of that type of stuff? What are the backdrops? What about the camera angles, the lighting, the sound, the music, the editing? How does that impact the meaning and the message that the commercial is sending? Does it verbally or visually offer any cultural mythology or narratives or anything like that? And then any cognitive shorthands, that's what those ideas are called, cognitive shorthands. Contrast, reciprocity, consistency, social proof, liking, authority, scarcity. Is there anything in there? And then anything else you can possibly think about. So let's take a look at this commercial, and I'll bring this back up. It's under bookmarks. By the way, I haven't looked at the polls today. Again, I don't want to do that, but I'm going to anyway, because it just sustains this whole horse race thing. Who's winning right now, this very second? Have you seen it? I haven't seen it. I imagine Clinton, as I mentioned earlier, is up, but I haven't seen anything. Oh, come on. Okay, what do we got here? General election, Trump's up too. From Rasmussen, is that right? Ty in the ULA Times, NBC has Ohio. Trump is up one in Ohio, but the other thing has Clinton up. La 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 la. Georgia, Trump is up. No, no kidding. Really interesting to see all this type of stuff. But in any case, okay, there we go. La 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 la. So, here, underneath the tab that says political commercial stuff, I have Trump ad, Clinton fail. And it's a little story. It's of, I don't know, where is it from? But here is the actual ad. Come on up. You can do it. Oh, come on. And it sort of does a little tiny bit of an analysis of this ad, but not very good. Okay, you can do it. You can do it. I know it. You can do it. Okay. Oh, come on. See, Clinton has already failed us because it's slow. Ah, damn. Don't. Oh, come on. Apparently, it's called Dangerous. That is the name of the ad. Usually, they give the ads names. Would you go? My computer sucks. Come on, you can do it. Come on. Nah. Well, I'm not gonna just hang out here forever to see if this is gonna work. Let's see if I can find it on YouTube. Maybe that'll be faster. Well, that is YouTube. Not even YouTube's coming up. What's going on? Well, in any case, what we see is lots of stuff about Clinton and all the dangerous situations that we are in the country. And then, and then it shows a bunch of things of Clinton stumbling and coughing and everything like that. The music is really problematic, and that is, it has the very evil sounding music while all this stuff is going on when it's talking about Clinton. God, I wish this would come up. Everything's just stopping. Okay, screw this. Take a look at it, and then use those use that stuff to see what's going on, because I think that would be helpful. I will try it one more time. Clinton Dangerous. No, there's something funky going on. Maybe I'll come back with this if it's working later on, but I'll just leave it at that. Let me know if you have any questions as you go through the exam study guide. I'm